BBC Audio presents Doctor Who, Dalek, by Robert Shearman. Read by Nicholas Briggs. Prologue. It begins, as it so often does, with a boy standing on a hill. It is a little hill, for he is only a little boy. And from the top of it, he can see the entire world stretched out before him. Lush, rolling fields, and thick-trunked trees, and deep lakes, and No, it is a big hill. The very biggest the boy can imagine. It shoots up higher and higher. How high can it possibly go? On the peak, the boy feels as if he's scratching the sky. He's not sure how he feels about that. Maybe he begins to feel just a bit afraid. We don't want the boy to be afraid. Not just yet. So, a boy stands on a medium-sized, perfectly unthreatening hill. And he is happy. He can see for miles. The rolling fields, yes, and the thick-trunked trees, and there is something missing. What is it? The boy suddenly realizes there are no people. There is no one anywhere, not in any direction, no matter how hard he looks. He is entirely alone. The boy wonders whether this should bother him, and then decides that it doesn't. No one. Not even his parents. But it's fine. It's good. The boy then wonders why he can't remember his parents, whether he even has parents. Should this bother him too? He's not sure. He'll put it aside for a while. He'll work that one out later. The peace of it, the utter unbroken tranquility. And all around him, fields rolling, trees thick, lakes deep, and yes, up above that too, that rich blue cloudless sky. Just look at it. Doesn't it make your head spin? Why, it could go on forever. The boy revels in it. The freedom. And more than that, the isolation. And from deep within, a thought suddenly occurs to him.
Enjoy this while you can, because very soon the others will come. So many others, you have no idea. There'll be so many, and they'll blot out the sky. They'll block your view of the fields and the trees and the lakes. They'll fill in every last bit of space, and you'll never, ever be on your own again. The monsters are coming.
The boy pushes these thoughts away. He tucks them into the part of his mind that's still worrying about why he can't recall whether he has parents or not, and what his own name is, and isn't he actually in pain? Isn't there some terrible pain he's refusing to acknowledge? The sky is vast and empty, and is broken only by a kite. And then the boy realizes with delighted surprise that it's his kite, and he's the one holding the string. There doesn't seem to be any wind, not so much as the hint of a breeze that could disturb the calm of the scene. But the kite darts about the sky anyway, dipping this way and that, as if it's an overexcited child that can't keep still, as if the kite was a little child and this boy was a big grown-up looking after him. It makes the little boy laugh. Its wings are fragile, and only the little boy can protect it, and he will protect it. It's his mission.
The monsters are coming. They're getting closer. And once they're here, you'll never be alone again.
The boy loves the pull of the kite in his hands. That he's got it under control. That he's the one giving orders.
The monsters.
And from behind a cloud he didn't even realize was there, the sun breaks through. And it's warm and it's beautiful, and it fills the world. The boy stretches out his hand towards it. He wants to touch it. The kite is loose. He's lost the kite. The boy doesn't care. Straining high to reach the sun, on his tippy toes now, the little boy with his little arms and his little fingers itching for that warmth. It's a moment of pure joy. This boy, this nothing boy without a name or family or future, daring to bask in the sunlight. And the green of the grass and the brown of the trees and the blue of the sky and all the colours and all the smells and so many ideas. He has so many ideas and things he wants to do and say and feel. The monsters say, "These ideas are not for you." His arm is too heavy. It drops hard to his side. No, his whole body is too heavy. He cannot move. The world, suddenly, is too heavy. He watches helpless as the kite crashes to the ground. Too fast, too hard, those fragile wings shatter on impact. The boy manages to say one word. "No!" And it doesn't sound like the voice of a boy. It's already harsh and grating and so, so old and so, so tired. Even the sky is too heavy. He can feel the vast weight of it as it bears down upon him. As it contorts and tapers into an enormous finger, as it presses down hard, as it squashes him deep into the hill. The boy is no longer there. And then the hill is no longer there. There is only that weighty, murdering sky. And then the sky is no longer there. It's gone. It's gone. This world has been snatched away. It's gone forever.
The monsters are here. Never forget what you cannot be, and never forget what you truly are.
Chapter 1. The creature was in constant pain, but it had stopped caring years ago. It dimly remembered caring. Sometimes it would struggle to recall what that felt like, to care. It had felt good, hadn't it? But the memory was too weak to grasp onto. It was one of the things that had fallen away and was lost. Like so many of the other things. Power. Pride. Point. The creature was not afraid to die. Not if dying was part of its mission. But the problem was exactly that. It couldn't be sure. Some days it believed it entirely, that death was its sole purpose now, and the realization washed over like cool relief. But then the doubts would get in. What if instead its purpose was to stay alive? Was that possible? It was surely possible. What if survival really was now its only function? So then, survive. Live on. No matter how hard the suffering. And so that's how it had existed all these years, caught between the not quite living and the not yet dying, keeping its options open, waiting for new information that would help determine which was better, the agony of the torture no worse than the agony of the indecision. It was a wonder it hadn't driven the creature mad. But it wasn't mad. Not yet. Not quite.
The human is here again.
The one with the drill. Some days the creature hates the human. That feels right. It is good to have hatred for the enemy. But hatred makes his nerves come alive when it is usually easier to hide within the numb. And besides, the creature knows that the man is just fulfilling its purpose. Its purpose is to make the creature's life unendurable. And although the man is failing because the creature is enduring it, it is, having a purpose is still something the creature can respect. Better the human with the drill than the other humans. The ones who come in to clean away the bloodstains on the floor and never dare to look at it. Better him than the man who comes to inspect and to plead for it to talk, to beg. The creature hates that man in particular, and cannot help it, no matter that the effort of such hating sets its nerves on fire. The human with the drill is here again, and the creature knows that the pain is about to increase tenfold, and there's nothing it can do about it. And it envies its torturer a little, not for the ability to inflict pain, but that it sets about its task so thoroughly. And it's true.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.